years coming at the French Open and in that clay court season.
Do you think Jack is going to have to develop more than just grinding? I mean, he's a big boy.
Yeah,
you know, well, he's getting bigger, it seems like. I don't know if he's finished growing.
Yeah, when I say, you know, he can grind, he can, but his first choice is to absolutely clobber that forehand. So
right. He's
got one of the bigger weapons on tour. You see probably the biggest forehand on tour this week with Juan Martin Del Potro, and up there with it is Jack Sock. I think they always do those RPM studies at Grand Slams, and it's Jack Sock and Rafa Nadal are always one and two in those formats.
Johnson serving to start the match.
It's just an extreme grip that takes a little time, but when he has the time to set up, man, his forehand is one of the biggest weapons out there.
Yep. It's interesting you asked Steve about his college career. That seems like so long ago, though. He is, you know, arguably, would you say the greatest player in college tennis history? I mean, he's right up there in the conversation. I mean, with what he did.
Yeah, just in terms of the records, I'd say he's got a chance to be considered the greatest college player of all time.
He won 72 matches in a row when he was at USC.
Just incredible to think that if you're even close to the same level as someone to win 72 in a row.
Sock saying that was out. So we're going to have our first Silver Sea challenge here.
This is a pretty big moment already, the first game of this match.
And Sock was right. So that's going to give Jack Sock break points. And there's a break right away. So Sock takes control of this opening set in the first game. Jack Sock chose a different path to professional tennis, didn't go to college.
Yeah, it was interesting. I was talking with the guys and talking about the Davis Cup, and this foursome now with Steve Johnson, Jack Sock, John Isner, and Sam Querrey, you got two guys that didn't go to college at all, and Sam Querrey and Jack Sock went straight to the pros, turned pro around 17, 18 years old, and two guys that went all 4 years to college, which is a little bit more of a rarity these days. Neither actually graduating, just for a side note. John and Steve like to claim that they did, but neither quite have that degree. But they did go all 4 years, because they like to make fun of me, because I didn't quite complete my degree either.
But at least you got to say you went to Harvard.
Exactly. I figure 2 years of Harvard is pretty much the same as four at Georgia or USC anyway. But with the different paths, it just shows that you can get. There's different ways to get to the top level in sports, and especially in tennis, such an individual sport.
You've kind of got it made, James, because you can impress people depending on who they are. You can say I was a professional athlete,
or if
it's a different type of person, you can say I went to Harvard. And that's some good credentials, man.
All of it means nothing to my kids.
Well, of course not.
All they want is food. Anyway,
no, of course not.
Free school. You got to do it.
Great variety by Jack mixing up that second serve. It'll be interesting to see. I saw Steve come over that first return, hitting the two-hander. He's much more comfortable hitting the slice, but he's been working on hitting a few more two-handers, and we'll see how much he breaks it out today.
How can you try to neutralize Sock serve? Is there a way?
Well, I mean, some players, again, it's a different difference of opinion. Some players feel like they need to guess a little bit. I don't know if his is as big as the Karlovic type of serve. Where guys like Karlovic and Isner, you feel like you almost have to guess. I don't know if you have to do that with Jack, but when he's mixing it up well, he does make it really difficult. And the better returners are going to maybe take a step in and take it a little earlier, but it's just not easy when he's making first serves. That's why getting free points on a serve is a key for him, because if he does, it's going to make it really difficult all day long for Steve Johnson to have any looks to get a break.
So in the blink of an eye, Sox up 2-0.
Too much sweat on the court. I'm a huge shotgun. I love Sox.
There's the big forehand from Steve where he's working Jack around and moving him, and that's... He didn't quite manage to do that in the first game, but if he gets his rhythm and starts feeling it, that's his best play.
I remember talking to Craig Boynton about Steve. This was a couple of years ago, and he said that one of the interesting challenges for Steve trying to make that jump from college tennis to the tour level was learning how to lose, because he just hadn't really lost that much.
It's true. One thing about him, one of the reasons he won so much there and is a winner on tour is right there, the intangibles. That was a complete half volley, just a bit of a broken point, and he manages to win so many of those points. Part of that's athleticism, part of that's him just finding a way to win.
So Johnson on the board here in the opening set. The winner of this will play. Huge moment for both of them.
Yes, it was. That's an incredible feeling to get a medal for your country. And Jack went down there and got another one in the mixed doubles as well.
Yeah.
Gold and a bronze. Pretty good Olympic haul there. That right there, a lot of people would think it's tough when you return to Jack Sox forehand. I think that's not the brightest thing in the world, but it does open up the backhand side a little bit, and that's part of neutralizing the forehand, is opening up that side a little bit to attack the backhand.
Where do you need to hit to the forehand, though, so that you don't get burned by it?
Well, you got to pull him out. You can't let it sit in the center of the court. Right there was Jack didn't execute with that last one. He missed that into the net, but you saw Jack's unbelievable ability to move. His footwork is very underrated. Steve hit two pretty good backhands into the backhand corner, and Jack was able to get around both and hit forehands. And I talked to Coach Craig Boynton beforehand, and he just says, Jack, it's so difficult to find the backhand. You really do have to open up the forehand because he moves so well to that side. That's what makes him so tough. Forehand's such a big weapon, and he does a great job of getting it.
By Johnson.
Great move. That's a little bit of the intangibles. He took that one early. Jack jammed him right into the body. Steve fought it off and saw that it was deep. Sneaks in real quick, and Jack actually has a very good lob off that backhand side, but Steve, a great athlete, getting back, taking care of the overhead.
So now triple break point. Sox in trouble. He got the break in Johnson's first service game. Bad miss by Sock, and we're back on serve. 2-2.
That one definitely a little uncharacteristic. He had two over in the backhand corner there that game where he made some errors that Jack, you wouldn't normally expect Jack to make. He does have little bit smaller margin of error with how quickly he swings that racket, but he's usually pretty precise with that one.
Yeah, the conditions here can sometimes be challenging from a wind standpoint, but it's not that breezy today. Johnson certainly didn't seem like he was all that frustrated after he got broken. He's held his composure really well.
He does generally handle the ups and downs pretty well out there.
That is just perfect.
Speaking of precision, that's Jack Sock right there. Steve, handling the ups and downs, that's a part that some people kind of overlook when they think about the tour. You have to handle the ups and downs every single match. Very rarely is it great first game, move through a match comfortably, and never face any adversity.
Oh, what a return from Sock.
Just missing your spot on the serve. He gave Jack a little too much time to step up and hit that forehand. I like the idea of sneaking in, coming in once in a while, because Jack sometimes will just block the returns back because he's got such big swings, but that time he was ready for it.
How would you describe the off-court personalities of these guys, James?
Jack, I would say, is a little more outgoing. He likes being around a ton of people. Steve keeps himself a little more. He's got a very dry sense of humor. Great athleticism again. I'm actually surprised he didn't make fun of me in the pre-match interview when I was talking to him in the players' lounge earlier. He was planning on coming back with whatever I asked him with making fun of my golf game. So I'm surprised he didn't. He's usually I think sometimes people think he's very serious and they don't realize that he's just about always joking around.
Johnson, right?
Yeah, that's Steve. Yeah. Jack makes fun of me for plenty of other things, but not as much about my golf as Steve does. Steve has, I will give him credit, he has beaten me the last two times we played.
Oh, Sock running around that backhand.
Again, just that footwork, so good. He was in the alley to hit that and still, you know, didn't seem like he was that far out of position because he gets back so quickly. He was actually outside the alley. That's confidence Steve Johnson has from winning a lot. That's the serve that he hit that he got burned on earlier. This time he hit it and just executed a little better. Got Jack stretched out further, and it's effective. He's not afraid to go back there.
Johnson again. This is the side he got broken on earlier. But instead of facing break point, game point.
That's one place I would give Steve a little bit of the advantage is that slice, the backhand slice to get back into a point, to play defense with. Steve's very, very good with that.
That's a big serving there by Steve Johnson to avoid the break. So we're on serve. Stevie Johnson back in.
Be in a competition next week in Mexico.
Yeah, Acapulco is next. Both these guys are scheduled to be there as well. Then Indian Wells.
There's Steve looking to come over that two-hander again, as opposed to where he sometimes is more comfortable just chipping that back in the slice. Very well done with the two-handed. Now he's might be feeling a little more comfortable since he's been trying to go over it more. And part of that is the matchup, because he knows with his slice, if he doesn't hit it perfect, Jack's going to be able to get around and get his forehand and really dictate play with the forehand.
Hey, James, in such a global sport, do you really put a lot of stock in being the top-ranked American? I mean, is that a thing?
It's definitely a thing. It's something that's important, and you realize how... I think when you do accomplish it, you realize the company you keep. There really aren't that many that have held that title, because there's been dominance by quite a few. So it's only, I think, about 20 and 25. If you look at the names, you got Sampras, Agassi. If you think of some of the names that didn't do it, Michael Chang was never the number one ranked American. He's in the Hall of Fame, but he was never the number one ranked American. He got to two in the world.
Yeah.
Just happened that at that time he was, you know, looking up at Pete Sampras and one of the greatest of all time. So you think about the people that have been the number one ranked American, and just about every one of them is someone you look up to and respect and think pretty highly of their tennis game. So it's something when you accomplish that to think about for a second and stop and appreciate.
Tough slice backhand from Johnson. Just knifed it. Look at these rally shots.
And that's, I was talking about Jack Sock's incredible footwork, and that's what he uses it for. He wants to hit as many forehands as he can and as few backhands, and he's doing a great job of that so far.
He covered some real estate in that point.
And if you look at more of Steve Johnson's matches, you'll see that it won't normally be 50-50. He'll usually hit a lot more forehands as well. But Jack is really the one that's forcing him to hit 50-50, because he's really pounding it to the backhand side a lot more to get Steve to hit a few more of those.
That could cost him. As Sock now has a chance again to break. Broke Johnson in Johnson's first service game and then got broken back. Sock once again is in front by a break. We'll find out if he can hang on to this break. He lost it the last time. So once again, Steve Johnson is down a break here in this opening set. Just a couple of those.
Yeah, that you don't see that often from Jack. He's one of the best doubles players in the world. He may not play as much doubles this year because he's going to focus more on the singles, but so accomplished on the doubles court and feels very comfortable moving forward. Able to stick those volleys away. Characteristic errors to start this game, and
a little bit of an opening
for Steve now. See, last time he had this chance, Steve took advantage. He really took it to him. Moved forward on a second serve. See what kind of opportunities Jack gives him here.
Could not get out of trouble the last time he was in this situation.
Correction on 125 mile an hour first serve, Fergus Murphy.
See if he's right.
Well, Steve's accepting it as right. So credit to Fergus Murphy. Good eyes out there in the chair. Now Steve Johnson gonna challenge this one. I think he's really committed to it, but it's worth trying, he thinks. If it could give him a chance to get love 40 instead of 15-30. Line, clutch serve from Jack Sock.
Johnson finds that backhand and finds break point as well.
He finds the backhand, and that's where Jack on the run trying to hit that slice. It has improved, but that's still where he can work a little bit more on getting that defense. That's a way to neutralize the forehand in his mind, but hasn't been able to do it with a couple of times today.
So Sock again in trouble of getting broken back.
Really, it's bread and butter. He's so good at hitting that backhand slice and just not missing it, keeping it in play. And I think that's the effect of Jack Sock's forehand. He really wants to keep it as far away from it as possible and pull him out towards the alley, and maybe tried to pull it a little too far over there and missed it. That's not like him.
Johnson still has break point. Too easy.
It's one of those returns that you're kind of sorry about. You definitely didn't intend to do it, but it ended up perfect. It was just short enough and made Jack have to hit up on the ball. And Steve doing a good job, just like Jack Sock, moving his feet, getting a forehand out of this. He feels so much more comfortable hitting a forehand, even from the alley, with a passing shot there.
Would you have predicted four breaks a serve?
Definitely not. I would have predicted one, maybe two.
Half of our games in this set have been breaks.
Yeah, that's definitely surprising.
Back on even terms now. Four all each time Sock has had the one break lead. Seems shaking his head. Frustration. Collins has had three double faults here in the first set. Make it 4-2 in this game for Steve Johnson. He's in danger of getting broken again. 15-30. Sock hasn't earned one of these points yet.
Surprising. A lot of this has been great tennis up to this point, 4-all with some of the breaks and some really good returns. And this game from Steve is a little more on his racket, where he's giving away some points here.
Break point again. Johnson's been broken twice already this set.
There's the much safer slice that Steve Johnson hits a lot, and I think he's gone away from it because he knows how much Jack Sock can punish it with that forehand. And that time, Jack a little in front of it, just misfiring a little bit, but it's also possible because Steve hasn't been going to that as much today.
Well, Johnson saves a couple of break points for the first time, and now back on even terms.
Both of those first serves were what I would consider pretty safe. They were into the backhand side, a little bit more kick on them, not the huge one. I think that's because he doesn't want to face a second serve right now after double faulting twice in this game. Both got the desired result for him, that's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty smart of him. Good backhand return Sock hit to start that point.
It really was, and he's just so aware. He's good around the court. As soon as he hit it, he moved directly to his left, getting ready to hit a forehand. He knows if he hits a good return, there's almost no way Steve's going to make him hit a backhand because of how well Jack moves. He got the point started with his forehand, and if you can start controlling the point from the return on Steve Johnson's first serve, you've done something right, that's for sure.
So it's another break point facing Johnson. Jack Sock breaks again. This time he'll serve for the set. He's not been able to hold a break the entire first set, but he's just done it with this backhand up the line.
I feel like he'd be pretty comfortable as we look at Troy Hahn. I think anytime he feels like he can break twice in a set, he thinks he's going to win that set. Troy Hahn's done a great job with Jack Sock. He's worked with him. Also want to congratulate him. He's a new father. Congratulations, Troy.
All right.
These kind of things always put the tennis matches into perspective. And Troy's learning about being a new dad, and so far loving it. Beautiful daughter at home in Indiana right now.
And we're going to have a silver sea challenge here. As a Johnson challenge, whether that was out. It was definitely out. Sox serving for the set. By the wind and ended up being really short. See, when he threw that lob up, it just seemed to stop in the air.
the ball to come back from the crowd. Commotion there.
Bad miss there for Sock. Instead of giving him a set point, it's 30 all.
I mentioned earlier in the Porsche Keys is the free points on the serve, and I definitely thought both players would get a lot more free points, so they've both done a good job of not allowing the opponent to get as many free points as they're used to.
There's a free one.
He went on cue for Jack, and that's what he needed. Gave a fist pump, knows how important getting those free points is, especially at this stage.
Yeah, it brings him to set point. Well, it wasn't the prettiest of sets, but Jack Sock will take it. It's not often you get broken twice and still win the set. Played. Was in Auckland earlier this year. He's won the first set again by the same score. Jack keeps looking at his left hand.
Wonder if he's gonna. Needs a little tape, got a blister or something on that possibly. It gets a little hotter out and hasn't been hot previous days. Sometimes you get a little bit of a, you can get a little blister, especially on the, for him, left hand, on the left hand is not used and is raw usually as the right hand, the more dominant hand.
Johnson's really struggled with his serve today. Just not been able to make an impression. All those three breaks against it, and he's had a lot of double faults.
I think a lot of it has to do with him trying to adjust for what Jack's been doing on the return side. Steve's serve is generally one of his biggest weapons. Had so much success last year on the grass courts, and that had a lot to do with the serve and moving forward.
Again, Sock has a lead on a Johnson service game.
Big free point for Steve.
It's his first ace.
For him getting a lead in this set, since he never really had one in the first set, he got broken first game. I think it would go a long way in his mentality, just to feel like he's leading on the scoreboard at any point. Maybe free him up even more on the returns.
Pretty point Sock.
It's a good solid return. Center of the court, you'd still expect Steve to make that. Jack stepped forward to hit that one and took a little time away from Steve, but Steve's usually able to at least retrieve that one.
Starting to see a lot more shanks out here now. I wonder if the wind is becoming more of a factor.
A little bit more breezy, but that one maybe just didn't quite get his feet all the way there.
Pretty good slice from Sock.
Yeah, it was a good slice, and that's one though that Steve expects to make, and I think he's looking over or thinking about the fact that Jack's passing shots are so good, so he's trying to make this cut that one so close. He hits a little bit more safe slice coming forward on that one, and he knows the caliber of opponent he's up against.
Yeah. Well, both guys really flirting with that baseline.
Yeah, both of them doing such a great job of not allowing free points. That was a big first serve from Steve that for most people it's going to be a service winner or an ace, and Jack stabs it, gets the racket on it, and actually puts it deep. These guys are both doing a great job of blocking back these first serves.
Johnson has battled back, has not gotten through his service games effectively at all today. Now has game point. And Johnson holds. Yep. Both guys just look uncomfortable today. They just don't look like they've really settled into their games yet.
Part of it is what the opponent's doing to them.
Yeah.
They know each other's game so well and what they're trying to do. So you see here where Steve Johnson's hitting it, as to be expected. He's going much more to the Jack Sock backhand, and I like seeing that there's only 8% really in the center of the court. He's trying to stretch him out, try to open up the 25% to the forehand. You're generally doing that to try to open up the backhand side so you can really get offensive and go into the backhand, maybe move forward, or at least just rip forehands into that backhand side of Jack Sock. So if I was starting out the match, that would be about the percentages I'd be thinking of for Steve Johnson to be effective.
Sucks. Yeah, he's going to go to the Silver Sea Challenge. And
that was an excellent slice by Steve Johnson, regardless of what this says. It was
good, yeah. So they'll replay that point. It's on the opposite side of Fergus Murphy, so he could really make a clear call there.
It's also pretty close.
Yeah.
Tough to see 100% on that one.
Sock makes the most of his second chance.
Yeah, it's a good 1-2 punch. Serve out wide. Get him stretched. Again, both these guys doing a good job of making the opponent play on the first serves. Steve, of course, would have liked that one to be a little deeper, but he's just doing what he can to get it back in the court. Not much you can do about that one.
A couple of big serves back-to-back for Sock. Moves him out to a 40-love lead. Nice recognition by Sock, and he holds serve. 1-1 here to start the second set. See some shot placement here by Jack Sock. Sock not going up the middle that much either.
Yeah, he's a little bit more balanced because he's got a little bit of a bigger forehand, so he can afford to really rip that one into the forehand side more so than Steve. And I would expect to maybe get that to the backhand side a little bit higher. 48%. I'd look for him to get up maybe into the 50s over onto that to attack Steve Johnson's backhand.
Good get by Johnson.
He really is a good athlete.
Well, yeah, I mean, you talked about his golf. that pretty much says he is.
Yeah, frustrating. Hits it a long way.
It's just been a match really with no rhythm to it.
Yeah, it's surprising. You would think with these two servers, you'd see maybe just like one break in the first set for a 6-4 and every game kind of going according to plan with a server, but definitely hasn't been that way today.
Johnson, though, has held serve now two games in a row, which is a rarity for him. On serve here in the second set. Was up early. Sock took a little longer to get out onto the court. What does Jack Sock need to do to stay the top-ranked American? What's the next step for him and his progression?
I think it's just the consistency. The top level is there. When he's hitting his forehand and kind of cracking on all cylinders, he's right there. It's just doing it week in and week out, not having real lulls in the season. The wheels from both guys there are both very impressive. And for Jack, I think that's going to come. It's just I think he's making a commitment this year to play a little less doubles, especially in the slams. Look at this. This is a good movement by Steve. Great hands. And the speed, the closing speed from Jack there slid almost into the net. And I think the focus on the singles and not playing as much doubles, it'll keep him healthy. Towards the end of last year, you saw how much success he could have singles and doubles, but it can probably take a toll if you're playing that much singles and doubles. So
we'll have doubles on this court next. Brian Brothers will take on Lou and Pace.
This is one of the tournaments Jack elected to not play doubles. He's already got this title. He carried me to a title here back in 2013. I think that's important. He's going from here to Acapulco, then Indian Wells and Miami, and if he's looking to get into the top 10, he's looking to be late in a lot of those events. Mm-hmm. And you need all the energy you can summon to be going deep in those. You don't want to run out of gas a little bit in the quarterfinals of Indian Wells or the semifinals of Miami. You need to have everything left in the tank. So I think it's a good decision for him to make sure that if he's out there a lot, it's because he's winning a lot of singles matches, and that's a good problem to have.
Of course, he's also a Grand Slam champion. He and Pospisil won Wimbledon a couple of years ago. Pospisil was here as well this week.
I mean, they're very similar in a lot of ways, and they are both great athletes, especially when the ball goes up over their heads. This is not an easy shot that Jack hit here to control it perfectly. It's really difficult to get anything on it, so you have to place it perfectly. Otherwise, Steve's going to be there.
Both these guys actually played high school tennis. Talk about their both being great athletes. It's interesting that they both decided to play on their high school teams. I remember Jack Sock in Kansas. It was Overland City. Park. It was 80-0.
Yeah, I would say playing high school tennis speaks more to them being good guys and good team guys and wanting to be a part of that. If you're at this level and you see these guys both clearly are, you can play high school tennis and you're gonna win. You're gonna be 80-0 like Jack Sock was. So It's more about being nice to the other teammates, and you're maybe not getting pushed quite as hard in high school tennis if you're at this level.
Johnson was the Los Angeles Player of the Year twice in high school. A little opening here.
Jack really just covering those last two, just a little bit too much on top of them, pulling them just down into the net.
Johnson seems to be serving a little better here in this set. And he holds for a third time. So still no breaks. We had a ton of breaks in the first set, but we're on serve here in the second. Jack's a second career title.
You like not have a conversation with him while I'm serving?
Jack Sox had quite an interesting career already, James. I mean, a two-time Olympic medalist, a Wimbledon doubles championship, top-ranked American. He's only 24 years of age.
Mixed doubles Grand Slam champion.
Yeah, mixed doubles,
Melanie,
that's right.
That was a long time ago. Yeah, first put him on the map there. I think he was only 18 years old at the time. Oh! Got a lot of different skills, and it translates very well for him to doubles, and he's a natural and instinctive player. You don't see that as much with such a young player to be that good just out of instinct on the doubles court.
Was just murdering those forehands.
Yeah, and against most people, he would have already put the ball away once there, twice there. Steve gets to it, and Jack has to put it away a third time. It's too much for him on this point. Slight opening here for Steve Johnson.
Johnson was all the way in the fence. Could have touched it with his hand, probably.
Yeah, that's sometimes the kind of defense you have to play when Jack gets rolling with that forehand. It's not easy. As I said, one of the keys is to try to neutralize that forehand, but it's not easy to do. It's a lot easier for me to say that and write it down, but tough to get out there and do it when you're facing that forehand.
From 15-30 down, now he's got game point.
Those big forehands, that's what Jack wants to be doing in these points. Once he gets that first forehand, really just control, and especially getting them in the center of the court like that.
And Sock holds. So Jack Sock feeling a little pressure at 15-30 and came storming back in that game. Jack play any other sports, James? He a basketball player?
He does like playing basketball. He's pretty good. I wouldn't put him on the same level. He doesn't have a shot like Marty Fish. He's a pretty good basketball player. There's some other guys out there like Monfils that can play some pretty good basketball. Jack's
Kyrgios too.
Kyrgios is a good player. Jack, he'll get out there and play. But I think also once you get on tour, you gotta be a little more careful. You realize that this is your job, this is your business. You're not gonna go out and play really full out and risk breaking an ankle, even jamming a finger or breaking a finger or anything in any sort of a full basketball game. Got new balls here for Steve Johnson to serve 3-all.
Oh. This tournament, actually, the players' lounge is located in a gymnasium, and half of it, the basketball goals are still up. And there have been some pretty good pickup games over the years in that gym. In fact, some of the players will use shooting baskets to warm up a little bit.
I'll admit to that being my warm-up a lot of times here in years past. Out there, run a few drills, go through a layup line, basically, to get the feet moving any way you can. And when you're on tour playing 25 weeks out of the year, you find a different way to do it and make it a little more fun.
Sokka issuing the silver seat challenge there. Ball was confirmed, 30 love. About what we expected.
A few people still finding their seats.
Oh yeah.
Just get our buses. Both guys, great job. Jack Sock trying to sneak in. Steve Johnson recognizing it, keeping it low, and good volley by Jack Sock, but just too good from Johnson. Heavy kick from Jack Sock on that one.
Johnson looked like he almost hurt himself returning it.
Yeah, he got a little ahead of himself. Thought it was going to be one place, and it jumped a little bit further than he had thought.
Whose second serve did you absolutely hate returning?
John Isner. Just coming in from a different angle, and the amount of heaviness and kick he could put on it could get up pretty high to my one-hander, and ace out of Jack Sock. Another thing that John did very well is he was able to mix it up after I could maybe step in and try to take it early. He would then change it up, adjust, and come right into my body with some pace and make it difficult for me to do that. So along with being 6'10 and having a huge serve, he actually serves smart as well.
Still game point for Sock. Seen a few of those today.
Yeah, that's one thing about the huge serve and the huge swing and the big forehand. Lots of RPMs. When he does miss, sometimes it looks pretty spectacular with the misses.
That was a good return.
Really good return. And Jack did everything he could to get all the way around it. Just couldn't quite get his feet completely around and made it a difficult shot for him.
So things getting interesting here now. Deuce. Oh, he missed it, but Johnson defends Sock's power so well.
It really did, and just the little intangibles that Steve Johnson brings, and right back up and bouncing around.
Yeah.
Still, he does handle the ups and downs so well, and that's some of the maturity he talked about going through college tennis. Even though he was winning all the time, he learned a lot in those 4 years at USC.
Yeah. Sock going right at him and hold serve as a result.
A quick thing about Steve when he did leave there, I played against him in Cincinnati in doubles, and afterwards I saw his coach, Peter Smith of USC. Excellent coach, excellent college coach. And I talked to him a little bit about the prospects of if Steve was going to turn pro or not, and he said, I'll tell you one thing, this kid is a winner. I don't know, I don't care what happens, what level he's on, he's going to find a way to win. And Peter Smith, one of the college coaches I have a ton of respect for, and I agree with him. He knows his players well, and he knows Steve, that he finds ways to win matches.
It's one of the reasons that Steve decided to go to college was because of Peter Smith.
Peter is like a five-tool baseball player, because half of college coaching is recruiting. So he's a great recruiter, but a lot of times he can be a great recruiter and not actually help the players. He's a great recruiter, and then he actually helps the players as a great coach too. So Steve, I think, made the right choice there.
Do you like coaching, James? Do you like working with guys?
Yeah, actually, that's about the most exciting thing for me. When I don't get out and practice a whole lot anymore, but the times I do enjoy it is hitting with a young player, whether it's Taylor Fritz or Francis TFO or someone like that, and just offering a little bit of advice. I'm definitely not going to be a full-time coach anytime soon, but I do like offering any sort of little tips I have. Which, if you ask them, it may not be many. That may not be very helpful.
I'm sure it is.
But I try, and a lot of it is more bigger picture stuff, thinking about schedule, thinking about just mindset when you're out there and stuff like that.
Game point, Johnson here. We're deep in the second set. Johnson will be trying to break to send it to a third. Sock, of course, will try to prevent that.
Guy's very capable of that, of sneaking in with a serve and volley, knocking off the volley.
Sock, he really hasn't done it that much, though.
He hasn't. He missed a couple early on, and maybe that sort of brought him to hesitate a little bit since then. What it does there, he's serving volley there, is it does make Steve Johnson think, and he was looking up there and decided, should I go to the two-hander, should I just slice it again? And that's why I like both of these guys doing it for that sort of variety, to make the returner think.
Wow. So what was he doing there?
40 love. try to get a free point at 40 love.
World record for fastest second serve. It's 128 in the net.
Yeah. I don't think if that was 30-40, it would have been the same second serve.
Yeah.
He's confident in his serve that he'll be able to get one of these next 2 points, I think.
He gets the next one. So 5-all second set. Pressure goes back to Steve Johnson. Sock really unable to carry over the momentum from winning that first set, because it was just such an error-filled set for both guys.
He had a couple of break points early on in this second set, and once he wasn't able to capitalize, it seemed like Steve's confidence on his serve rose, and he's been able to hold pretty comfortably since then. Some more free points like that.
Sock taking a look at it. Fergus Murphy said that it was good.
That's the mark there.
Doesn't challenge. Johnson, that was just his second ace.
Jack, in the last couple of games, making a concerted effort getting forward. Looks like it's going to pay dividends possibly late in the set. Be a little more nervous, tougher to come up with passing shots sometimes in those situations.
Boy, that was close. Just out.
There for Steve. I think he's hit two or three lines already this game. That one perfectly placed. To the backhand, get the shorter reply, and clean winner.
He's been pretty unflappable since the first service game of the set. And he continues to march forward, so 5-6 the score now. Johnson trying to pump himself up, and Sock will be trying to hold. Thinks about the workout plan for each of these guys, what they focus on?
No, I didn't get into the real specifics. I just know he was Jack was on the field doing a lot, not just on the court. He was doing a lot of longer distance stuff.
Is the endurance training important, James?
It is, and I think that's a big difference now in today's game as opposed to 20 years ago. Is it used to be probably 80% on court doing your tennis-specific stuff and then 20% in the gym or on the field or in the sand doing workouts. Wheels from Steve Johnson. I think nowadays you see it's 50-50. You're on the court for 2 hours and then you're in the field or in the gym or doing stuff for 2 hours as well. You're mixing it up a lot more because the game has become so much more physical. To be prepared for these kind of possibly third sets or for 3 out of 5 and for in the heat and just the length of the entire season for these guys.
Johnson comes forward and comes away with a point. It's 15-30.
I think Jack figured he might be a little tired after that, after running all that way for the last one. And Jack does have such good hands, but Steve up to the challenge and good with his hands too, able to push that deep and deep enough to cause trouble for Jack. That he wants that one back. He had a second serve and got a little bit out of his strike zone, just maybe crept up too high on him, and he still tried to be aggressive with it and it just flew on him.
It's a huge point here. Flirted with that service line. It's a little too tough for Johnson to handle, and instead of set point, it's game point Sock. And Sock steps up, and with one swat, sends us to a tiebreak. So Jack Sock could win this match in a tiebreak. Donald Young awaits the winner of this match. Darcy pulling out of the tournament. Sock the 3 seed, Johnson the 5 seed. And Sock gets the mini break to start the tiebreak.
It's a big first point. Just again highlighting his footwork. Watch him get around this. That's a pretty good knifing slice from Steve. But Jack just immediately, that first step to the left side is extremely quick. One of the quicker ones out there.
Set that up, didn't he?
Yeah, Jack was just biding his time. If Steve was going to keep giving him that slice over there, and Steve wasn't able to really push him back or do anything that effective, it's just he's really just trying to kind of fight off those big forehands from Jack. And then once Jack got one, he felt like he could really pull the trigger, takes it down the line to the open court.
Sock has been on fire here in the first 3 points of the tiebreak.
This one is, can't really fault Steve at all. Did a great job, and that is just too good of a forehand.
Sock has really seemed to bear down, played these first 3 points with way more intensity, it seems, more focus. Good serve by Johnson to get on the board. Just get that one mini break. That was the first point of the tie break. And Johnson launches that ball out onto Atlantic Avenue.
Jack had the opportunity to be prepared for that after the forehand passing shot that Jack hit. He kind of had a feeling it wasn't going to go to his forehand side, so Jack knew it was coming to his backhand and up to the challenge of getting him hitting a passing shot with the backhand too in this tiebreaker, and that's the reason for the 4-1 lead for Jack Sock.
Sock has just been dominant in 5 of the first 6 points of this tiebreak. Johnson has had no answer.
Yeah, it hasn't really that much his fault. Jack's just really raised his game.
You get an idea of just the potential he has and the game he has, the way he's played this tiebreak.
Like I said, the upside is there. If he's going to make an effort into the top 15, top 10 in the world, it's not going to be for a lack of ability or anything like that. It's just going to be the consistency, doing it week in, week out, not having lulls in the schedule and not having injuries.
He's 2 points away from the semis. Got away from him. He has a little bit of a cushion. Oh. 5'2" sock. And match points now for Jack Sock.
It's just been a tremendous tiebreaker for him. Takes that return even above his shoulders, but takes time away from Steve Johnson deep in the court. Sets up the big forehand. Whoever broke a little bit on that one. Wanted to end it with a little bit of a flourish. Still up 6-3. Two serves to come if necessary.
Well, 6-4. One more serve point here for Sock. His third match point. Jack Sock finishes off the match in straight sets, continuing his mastery over Steve Johnson and as a semifinalist here in Delray.